I will be reading from James 5, 13 to 20. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another, that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and heaven gave rain, and the earth bore its fruit. My brothers, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone brings him back, let him know that whoever brings back a sinner from his wandering will save his soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. At this time, children ages 4 to 6 are dismissed for the children's lesson.
Thanks, Kristen. Well, I trust it's been a good weekend for you. It's been beautiful, so we won't mention snow or anything like that and jinx it. It seems like the past 16 weeks, we've started the service with a comment about the snow, and now the snow is gone. So we won't even go there. But I trust that it's been a good weekend for you. As we begin, I think it's important for you to know, for you to be reminded this morning that you were never meant to do life alone. Never. The great theologian Charlie Daniels, from the Charlie Daniels Band, says in one of his songs, "I ain't asking nobody for nothing if I can't do it on my own." I think he's on to something. Right? That thought process has permeated so much of our culture, so much of what we hear and how we're taught, and that just it's on you. You do it by yourself, alone, isolate yourself from everyone else because you have enough strength and gumption. Right? That's the American way. I think one of Satan's greatest tactics is to pick off the solo artists. Right? You see this even in the Garden of Eden. Right? Satan goes not to Adam and Eve, but to Eve, and deceives her, and mankind falls into sin. Or you see this in nature. It's amazing to watch YouTube videos of lions like just going after. Like, notice they never go after an entire herd of something. No, it's always one. They wait and wait and wait, and eventually they find the one that's wandering off by themselves, a little bit slower, a little bit weaker, and then they get them. Right, even so much that not just these small little innocent gazelles, but it's amazing to watch a lion take down an elephant. Go YouTube that. I mean, it's profound. But Peter talks about in his letters in the New Testament, our enemy, our adversary is roaring, roaming around like a roaring lion, waiting for someone, looking for someone to devour. So I think one of Satan's tactics is to go after those that think, I've got this. I've got it on my own. I don't need anybody's help. I don't need anybody else around me. Or we live in an age of iTunes and iPhones and iPads, and we shift that to I everything. So I can just do my spirituality, my Christian life, my personal walk with God on my own. I don't need anyone else to assist with that. The U.S. Army has changed their slogan a number of times since their inception. And there was a 5-year period of time that their slogan, after be all that you can be, because that really wasn't working well, they shifted that to an army of one. And I think after 5 years, they realized it doesn't work. Right? Army, by definition, is a group of people. There is no such thing as an army of one. What's amazing, and as you read Ephesians 6, that, you know, put on the full armor of God, right? There's the shield of faith. And we, in our Western understanding, think of that as an isolated, I'm on my own, here's my shield and my sword. But what's profound about the way that shields were designed in first century to that original audience is that my shield only works when it's interlocked with the shields around it. My shield is only as strong as the shields that I'm standing in line with. So there is no army of one. You are not an army of one. You were never designed to be an army of one. In the 1950s, only 10% of the U.S. population lived alone. 10%. Today, it's nearly 30% in our culture. It's as high as 40% in San Francisco and Atlanta and Denver and Minneapolis. And then you get to New York City, Manhattan, or D.C., and it's 50%. And it's not just a problem in the United States. In Stockholm, Sweden, 60% of all households are just one occupant. And again, this mentality has crept into so much of what we do. And I want you to hear this morning that again, you were never designed to do your life alone. There are a lot of things you can do by yourself. Community is not one of them. You were designed, created, fashioned by God to be in community. And I think it's so important for you to know that's kind of been the driving force of so much of what we've tried to communicate since I've come, that this is life together. We gather together on Sunday mornings in worship. We grow together in community and in discipleship, and we go together to serve and to reach our community and the nations. Everything that we do together. I want you to know that our hope is that no one runs alone. No one. And that's the beauty of the church. In God's infinite wisdom, the way that he designed the church. Right? It's been a week, hasn't it? I mean, clearly I don't mean it's just been 7 days. I mean, it's been a week. It's been a week full of triumphs and defeats, of hospital rooms and nursing home visits, of phone calls and emails and cemeteries. Right? Birthday parties and celebrations and horrible news. It's been that kind of week. And our hope is that in every single one of those moments in your life, that there's someone around you, whether it's one person or 20 people that you turn to, that you call to, that are grieving with you, that are rejoicing with you, that are praying for you. That's our hope. And I think that's what James holds up for us in this closing section of his letter. It really is a beautiful way to end the letter. All of these things that we've been called to do, the fruit of our faith. And he ends with the importance of doing all of these things in community. So James 5, 13 to 20, I think what James is pointing us toward is that the church is essential for our own lives of fruitful obedience. Again, in God's infinite wisdom, that's the way he designed it. That's the way he set it up. So James's letter just ends, right? There is no final greeting or salutation. Paul so often when he ends his letter, is this long, kind of sweeping, beautiful way to end a letter. You know, grace and peace to you and our Lord Jesus Christ. Keep going, keep doing these things. James just ends. And it's a beautiful call to action. Like I said, at the end of, here's everything that I've communicated to you. Count it all joy when you meet trials of various kinds. Like, bear fruit. It's not simply enough for you to know the right things. You must live them out. Don't show partiality. I mean, all of these things. The tongue, you know, that you're called to control. How beautiful it is that all of those things end with the importance for us of community. Right? Because so much of that you can't do on your own. So now it ratchets up for us just the beauty of the church. One word that James has used over and over and over, 15 times, in fact, in this letter, 5 chapters, 15 times, is brothers. Brothers, dear brothers, my beloved brothers. Right? He's talking to the community. He's talking to the church. And again, emphasizing the importance of this. So, three things, the role of community in our prayerfulness, in our confession, and in our restoration. So verses 13 to 15, As was read, let me just read that again. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone among you cheerful? Let him sing praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the one who's sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he's committed sins, he will be forgiven. So some broad categories that I think fit every single part of our lives. Is anyone among you suffering? So suffering here is just general trouble. And what's profound about what's implied here is not if you're suffering or just troubled and life is just difficult, let him pray. The implication is don't pray for, that God simply removes those things from your life. But the prayer is of endurance, of persevering through that. And again, that takes us back to James 1. If any one of you is suffering, or count it all joy, my brothers, when you suffer and you face trials of various kinds, because the end of all of that, again, is your perfection, your holiness, and God's working in you. So it's not simply a prayer for removal, although that is very appropriate too. And we'll look at a text in a minute from Paul in 2 Corinthians 12 where he does that. Right, and then the second thing he says is, if anyone among you is cheerful, is anyone cheerful? Let him sing. Let him worship. Right, there's an internal well-being in the midst of everything else that goes on, this deep-seated joy in all that God has done. That again, it doesn't shift you around. Like God is, you understand this. You know, this is an image from the Psalms that God takes us out of the miry clay and sets us on a rock and puts in our mouth a new song. And this rock is immovable, right? The waves can batter your life. Storms come. And you know that what you've built your life upon doesn't shift. It doesn't move. It doesn't fail. And then there's this call. If anyone among you is sick. So this is both physical sickness and emotional distress. So Paul, in 2 Corinthians 12, you remember this story that Paul says, I had this messenger of Satan, this thorn in my flesh to keep me from becoming prideful. Three times I begged the Lord to remove it, and he didn't. So in good times and in bad, we confess our need for God. That's what he's saying here. In the midst of suffering, we pray. When things are going well and we're cheerful, then we sing. If we're suffering to the point that we can't handle on our own, we, in God's design, call the elders. So all of it takes the focus off of ourselves, and it puts our eyes and our hearts and our minds toward God in worship and in prayer. So worship, again, is what we were designed to do. We tend to think of worship in terms of what we do for three or four songs on a Sunday morning in a building like this. I don't go to many concerts. I actually went to a Charlie Daniels concert years ago. Lived in Berlin. I remember there with my dad. So I've not gone to many concerts. And if you do, what's profound about how people respond in those moments is this. Hands raised, eyes closed. Right? We're designed to worship. To worship means to ascribe value to something. And I know we're in the upper Midwest, and so when we sing, it's probably too much. Many of you go, I don't know, it's probably too much to leave my hands in my pockets, so you put them by your side. Maybe occasionally it's a hand raised. We're designed to worship, right? And James is saying, is anyone cheerful? Let him sing. There's something about your heart that's designed for that capacity. That you take your eyes off of yourself and you say, God, you alone are worthy. You alone have everything that I need. And so I'm going to sing. Both of those, in worship and in prayer, again, just removes the focus from ourselves. Again, Paul, in that text in 2 Corinthians 12, pleads with God to remove this from him. And Christ's response to Paul is no. I'm not going to remove this thorn from you. Instead, he says, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in your weakness. And then Paul says, then for the sake of Christ, I'm content with weakness and insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. Why? Because when I'm weak, then I'm strong. In my weakness, in God's sovereignty and Christ's favor for me, his grace being sufficient in those moments, in my own weakness, then the only course of action I have is to recognize that my strength is found in him. But many times throughout this text, the word that Paul uses is, or not Paul, James uses is among you. Is anyone among you suffering? Is anyone among you sick? If anyone wanders, anyone among you wanders? So the implication of what he's talking about is that amongstness is occurring. Right? There's an implication there that they're doing life together. And so if anyone among you is suffering, then here's the course of action. Eventually then he says, let him call the elders of the church. It's a beautiful word in the language of the New Testament. It's the word that we get ecclesiastical from, which simply means of or pertaining to the church. But in its original form, it's a verb that means to call out from. So the church, as we know it today, this gathering in a new community, is those that are called out from the world. It's those called out from darkness into light. We're given a new identity, a new community to be involved with. And it's a great way for us, again, to picture all of the importance of what God is doing in the midst of community. A friend of ours and his wife run a ministry in Chicago, and for 15 or 16 years, their heart is to disciple urban church leaders, urban church ministries toward discipleship. And one of the things he talks about with the church is that doing church as a community hurts much more than doing church as an event. But I'm convinced that God's character is formed in community. Community. Right? It's simple to do church as an event. This place, this time. Right? We've talked about this. We've kind of jokingly said we could have 1,000 people here on a weekend. Right? Give away a car. Right? We laughed. There's churches that did that this past week. Give away a car. We put in a rock wall and a wading pool and a golf course out back. But the reality is what you win people with is what you win them to. So you give away a car to get somebody in the door. Guess what? You got to give away a car every week to keep them there. So the beauty and the reality of the gospel is this very idea. Not church as an event, but church as a community. Of course it's going to hurt. Of course it rubs against us and our preferences and the things that we desire. But I'm convinced that this, like Brian says here, that I'm convinced that this is God's design for us. To do life alongside of others. And in the midst of this, it's not easy. Again, the context that James is talking about is suffering and illness and things falling apart, things not going your way. Sometimes they do, so we sing, but most of it are hard times that we walk through together. Together. It's amazing how often in movies you see that very image portrayed. Right, we got to go through there. Right, Lord of the Rings, you see this very same thing. Like they're on their way to destroy the ring, right? And they approach this mountain and go, there's no way to go over it. So Gimli, the little, I don't even know what he is now, troll, I'm sure my son will correct me later. Gimli says, if we can't pass over the mountain, let's go under it. We need to go through the mines of Moria. And Gandalf has this look of dread, this look of fear. And he says, let's ask the ring bearer. Let's ask Frodo, and Frodo said, let's do it. And Gandalf's response is, so be it. There are things in life that we would rather go around. There are things as a church we would rather go over. And the reality is we're called to go through them. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet these trials of various kinds. Because in the end, it's about our trusting and savoring and treasuring of Christ above all things. Because when we are weak, then we are strong. There's amazing promises here. The Lord will save, the Lord will raise, the Lord will forgive. Right? It's not because you do these things, where we utter words in a prayer the right way, then God must respond in certain ways. Right? There is this joke, you know, about God just being a cosmic vending machine. You know, you put your money in and you push the buttons in the right order and out comes what you want. That's not it at all. It is not the amount of prayer. It's not the right words in a prayer. It's not even that the prayer is ours, but that God is faithful and that God is sovereign in all of these things. The power for healing, the power for joy, the power for all of these things that God promises is not on us. Is not on us. Please hear that. It is on God Himself. The Lord will raise him up. Verse 15 is chocked full of that. The Lord will raise him up. The Lord will forgive. So, but it drives us in prayer to see that community presses us toward that. So the role of community in our prayerfulness. Secondly, the role of community in our confession. So if all of that's true in verses 13 to 15, especially verse 15, these promises that God will raise, that God will forgive, that God will save, verse 16 begins with, therefore. So if all that's true, then do this. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. So since all of those things are true, continue to do these things. And of course, again, this isn't comfortable for us. But notice, these are not suggestions. This is present tense imperative. This is a present tense, which means this is ongoing, day by day, tomorrow, next week, next year, do this. It's a command. It's not suggestive. Confess your sins to one another. Pray for one another. The context, again, is community. Again, it is so important for us to see. There are about 59 one another passages in the New Testament. There's two of them right here. But again, I said earlier, there are 1,000 things you can do by yourself. Discipleship, community, those aren't some of them. Right, even here. Confess your sins to one another. Pray for one another. It's amazing how often I've heard in ministry, James, I want you to pray. Right? You have a direct line to God Himself. God will listen to you. He won't listen to me. No. It's a profound misunderstanding of who we are in Christ. The profound promises that we have as believers to approach God. Right? This is all believers. Please hear, this is all believers. The prayer of a righteous person has great power in its working. This is not the super spiritual SEAL Team 6 of pastors and elders. God only listens to them. So you go to them and they will pray. No. I will gladly pray for you. But God hears you when you pray as well. We have one mediator, the Lord Jesus Christ, who lives daily to intercede for us. Right? When Jesus is crucified, the temple curtain is torn in two from top to bottom. That's not insignificant. It means that God's presence is now made available to all of us through Christ. So yes, I would love to pray for you. That's what we're called to do. Bring it to the elders. They will do these things. But Your role in prayer, your role in confession, God hears. We are called to do these things. I say that because of the word righteous. The prayer of a righteous person has great power. And I know, again, the tendency in our hearts to go, well, that's not me. I'm not righteous enough. Right? There is no scale of righteous, more righteous, super righteous. No, we are righteous or unrighteous. And by faith in Christ, God views us through the death of his son as perfect. That's what the word justify means. It is unbelievable that God, by my faith in Christ, Christ now represents me to the Father as perfect, as righteous, as holy, as blameless and spotless. That's how God views me because of what Christ has done. And that's how God views you through your faith in him, as righteous, perfect, holy. It is an amazing thing to be in right standing with God because of Christ. So in light of God's faithfulness and promises, confess and pray together in community. There are two results that come: healing and fruit. Some illnesses are sin-related. Some. Jesus, you'll remember, he was healing the man born blind, and the disciples asked, whose fault is this? His or his parents? Which of them sinned? Jesus said, neither of them, but so that the glory of God may be revealed. But listen to Paul in 1 Corinthians 11. He's ending his discussion about the Lord's Supper. Listen to what he said. If anyone eats and drinks without discerning the body, he eats and drinks judgment on himself. That's why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. So there are some sins that bring about physical results. So that's why confession matters. So it brings healing. Dietrich Bonhoeffer says, confession in the presence of a brother is the profoundest kind of humiliation. In the confession of concrete sins, the old man dies a painful, shameful death before the eyes of a brother. There's something profound about you bearing your soul in front of someone else, confessing your sin. Is it humiliating? Yeah, it is. Right, and we've so pigeonholed ourselves into categories that we think, this doesn't mean me, right? I'm an introvert. I don't like public speaking. I don't like talking to other people about that stuff. Right? I know where I land on the Enneagram and the DISC test and Myers-Briggs, so I get an out, right? No, you don't. Right? Is it vulnerable? Absolutely it's vulnerable. Right, if I were to ask you to raise your hand, I need a volunteer. I remember going to a youth camp once. I said, we need a volunteer. And of course, all the middle schoolers throw their hands up. And the speaker said, all right, you in the front, give me two of your unconfessed sins. As a joke. And this kid's like, ooh. We quickly volunteer for things, not knowing what we're volunteering for. Like, that's not confession. Right, let's stick a mic up front and we'll line up and everybody just bear your deep, dark secret. That's not confession. But it is something to say, man, brother, I'm struggling. Here's my week. Pray for me. Here's the sin that's crept into my heart this week of lust or greed or envy or jealousy. Pray for me as I confess this. That's where healing happens. This isn't public humiliation. I stand in the back and take notes. No, it's none of those things. It's for the spiritual health and vitality of your life. And we do it because, again, that word righteous is there. That the forgiveness that we've received in Christ frees us. So now we can turn to our brother and say, this is what I'm battling. You turn to your sister and say, pray for me this week. This is what's going on. Right? We can freely and openly share because we have been redeemed and forgiven in Christ. There is no sin. I've been in ministry almost 15 years. I think the first year I began to realize there's nothing I'm going to hear next year that won't shock me more than this year. Like, that's the reality of living in a broken world. And all of us are in the same boat. right? Your sin may look differently than mine, but it's still sin. Your brokenness may appear in different lights than mine. That's the beauty of running and doing life together in community and moving toward confession. And again, allowing our old nature to die a painful, shameful death. And I say health because, and fruitfulness because James uses Elijah as an example. Listen to what he says. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain for 3.5 years, and it did not rain. Then he prayed again, and heaven gave rain, and the earth bore its fruit. There's that word fruit that we've seen for 9 weeks now. Fruit. So in confession and in prayer, the result is that the end of the drought happens and fruit comes in your life. Vitality. So the last role of community is in our restoration. You see this in verses 19 and 20. Earlier we sang those lyrics, prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Yeah, there is a subtle danger tendency in all of our lives to again, subtly wander from the truth. That's what James says here. My brothers, if anyone among you wanders from the truth in James's mind is right living and right thinking, not either or. But what we believe to be true about God and how we live in light of that truth. And there's a danger in both of those of moving far away from the truth. Whether it's doctrinally or theologically or practically, right? There is a danger for us, very subtle, to wander from what's true. And this is why there is an invaluable necessity of the church. Right? The things that we sing on a Sunday morning, the things that we read on a Sunday morning are there as guardrails to say, this is who we are and what we believe to be true. Right? And we confess together, we sing together, we read together, the word is preached. Like all of that centers around the word of God so that it prevents us wandering from the truth. And I say us. Like it's so good for me to come and sing these songs and be reminded of the truths of the gospel alongside of you. Again, there's a beauty to the church in God's wisdom that he designed it that way. In Jude, verse 3, it talks about the church contending for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. That's what we do. We continue to contend for the truths of the gospel as they're laid out in God's word. Because the end, if this wandering is allowed to run its course, it ends in death. Because if you bring them back, James says, you will save a soul from death. This isn't physical death, but spiritual death. You wander really, really far away from the central tenets of Christianity. It's not Christianity anymore. You can call it what you want. You can call it Christianity. It ends up in the end not being Christianity. But listen again to the way that verse 19 is written, because there's a way that we want to read it, again, to place ourselves at the helm of, I'm the one that's going to go and bring the wanderer back. But that's not how James writes it. My brothers, if anyone among you wanders from the truth, there's a proneness here in all of our hearts to wander from the truth. That's why he begins it the way he does. He doesn't say, hey, when you see someone wandering, go and bring them back. No, if anyone among you, you are part of the among you. I am part of the among you. If anyone among you is wandering from the truth and someone brings him back, that's the role of restoration. But first and foremost, we must see that we're in the position of wandering, then recovering. The word roam here, oh, I'm sorry, the word wander here is where we get our English word planet, right? Just off on its own, doing its own thing, roaming about, astray, right? And James is saying, if you see that, restore them. Restore them. How? How do we do that? Two things. One is to hold up the beauty of the gospel, the beauty of God's glory. I love this quote from John Piper on this idea of the planet. He said that the Son of God's glory was made to shine at the center of the solar system of our soul. Right? So the core of who you are exists for the fame of God, for the glory of God, for the worship of God himself. And when it does, right, when God's glory is at the center of everything in your life, the planets of our life are held in their proper orbit. But when the sun is displaced, everything else flies apart. So we continue to hold up the good news of the gospel, the glory of God in all things. Right? Again, I've used this quote before. I mean, Martin Luther was asked the one time, why do you preach the gospel every week? He says, because every week you forget it. Like, we are prone to forget God's favor and love for us. So the second thing that we do to restore, the second way we do this is love. And this takes us back to chapter 4, this whole idea of placing ourselves above others, condemning them. And I said then that if we're condemning, we're not loving. We're not entering into their story and loving them, because the reality is that our need is the same as their need. Their need is the same as our need. That's why verse 19 reads the way that it does. If anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone brings him back, let him know that whoever brings back a sinner from his wandering will save his soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. Proverbs 10 says, love covers all offenses. Love covers all offenses. That's why we can confess. Because ultimately, I don't absolve you of your sin. Christ does that. So we can confess freely and love freely and restore freely, because the gospel frees us to do that and allows us to live our lives in transparent, humble, loving ways amongst others that are just as broken as we are. The times that I've grown the most have been in community. Sure, there's other times that spiritual growth happens, and I'm not diminishing the role of personal times of worship and personal times of study and scripture memory. But you were designed to be in community. And the times that I think that you will grow the most are when you run with other people who love you and care for you and are all running in the same direction of living a life that seeks to honor and glorify God in all things. Home Depot used to have a slogan. Maybe they still do. I don't know. We don't have a Home Depot anymore. So, well, Marshall doesn't have a Home Depot. We don't have a Home Depot since we've moved here. So, but they used to have a slogan that said, you can do it, we can help. Right? And you can pay them an exorbitant amount of money to come put some stuff in for you. But the reality is that should be a motto that undergirds us as a church. You can do it. Right? You can live a life of obedience and holiness and fruit. And we're here to help. We can do this together. We're called to do this together. There's a beauty about the church, about community, that holds up for us the guardrails and the support systems that we need to live lives of fruitful obedience. The model for us is the gospel itself. So again, this idea of wandering, right? You don't have to read too far to see we all, like sheep, have gone astray. But 1 Peter 3, the Apostle Peter says, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. Love that language. This imagery of Christ taking us by the hand through his death and bringing us back from wandering, from other affections, back to God himself. That's the model for us in all that we do, whether it's, again, these three things of prayer, praying, of confessing and restoring, and every other aspect of our lives, that the gospel is the motivation for us. But again, I want you to see that the church, the community of faith, is essential for your life, for the call on your life of bearing fruit that lasts. I think it's very fitting that at this time we're going to shift to taking communion together, gathering around a table of renewed and restored fellowship with God himself. This is a beautiful image that will carry on through all of eternity, of gathering around a table together. So you don't have to be a member of this church or this denomination. We would simply say that the table is open to all believers, but only believers. So in a moment, the elders will come, we'll pass the bread, and then I'll pray, and we'll take that together, and then we'll pass the cup, I'll pray, and then we'll take that together. This is a beautiful picture for us of fellowship, of community, of the outworking of the church, and God's love for us in Christ that restores us and welcomes us and loves us moment by moment, that will carry us for all of eternity. Well, I'm going to invite the elders to come, and I just invite you to prepare your hearts as we take communion together.
He is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us. Oh, oh, how he loves us. How he loves us all.
Let's pray together. Father, thank you in your infinite wisdom and infinite love for us that you sent your Son to bear a shameful death, to welcome us back into your presence for all of eternity. We pray in Jesus' great name. Amen. Let's eat together in remembrance of him.
Eclipsed by glory, and I realize.
Let's pray together. Jesus, thank you for your willingness to come, to take on flesh, to dwell among us, to identify with us in every single way, yet without sin. So that as you died, the offering and the sacrifice would be perfect on our behalf. Give us grace to grasp the depth of your love for us. We pray in your great name. Amen. Let's drink this morning, remembering his sacrifice for us. I'm going to invite the worship team to come for a closing song. There'll be some baskets that are passed for your cups, and we'll continue to worship this morning.
Psalm 117. Praise the Lord, all nations. Extol him, all peoples. For great is his steadfast love toward us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord. Let us praise and worship together and sing a song unto him. Thank you.
We were just joking before service about tripping and falling up or down the stairs, and I just about did that. So, for our benediction, 1 Peter 4, verses 7 and 8. The end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be self-controlled and sober-minded for the sake of your prayers. Above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins. Allow the gospel and your standing with God to draw you out and into relationships of love and community around you. So you are dismissed. Have a good week. We will see you next week.